first thing I'm going to do here is break this image up into two layers. I don't like having both of these guys on the same layer. So I got the rough down here, which is everything, and then I got the cowboy up here, which is by himself. I gotta do that to all of these guys. So this will take just a second to get knocked out. I'm doing this in Clip Studio, so I've got this handy little tool right here, the selection pen, that gives me the ability to just draw over the lines and get everything covered in. Don't worry about the roughness on this. When I get it located into its own layer, it's going to get cleaned up a lot. But right now, I just kind of threw the character in there on top of everything. So it's a little bit rough. And then the actual process here is going to be very simple. I cut this off of the rough layer, and then I paste it onto the brand new one. Of course, forgetting a key thing about Clip is that if I cut and paste, it's going to create a brand new layer anyway. And I don't have to be perfect with this. Probably putting a lot more effort into this than necessary. But there he goes. And then there he is. And I don't need that guy in there. So, rename this layer Dia, rename this layer Wagon, that way I don't forget it. And do that to this guy too. I don't have that many of these panels in there because I'm going pretty light on the animation for this portion of the scene, but I got enough in there to make it a pain in the backside. The key here, the goal here is once I get all of these separated onto their own layers, I can draw the individual elements a lot more in detail. And you're looking at the main number one reason why this freaking episode has taken so long to do, because I want to make sure it's done right. This should have been out weeks ago, yet here we are watching me do it again. Don't worry if the audio drops out and I kind of go silent. I don't really talk a lot while I'm drawing most of the time. But I know because I'm live streaming here and you guys don't know what's going on in my head while I'm doing this stuff, I kind of have to do a little bit of narration. So I'm trying to find a happy middle ground here. Really struggling with getting the anticipation put in here of him moving his body forward but the wagon not going. That's one of the things that I want to work out still, because while I got the basic on it, it's not anywhere near where I want it, so it still looks a little bit forced. I want to kind of just use the few scenes that he's got in here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Not that many panels, so I gotta I got to use a little bit of cheat code to get all of the stuff that I want in there. So that is what we're doing today. Kind of have a handicap on this because I'm working off of a tablet, not a pen display. So I am drawing this, as I'll show you here, which kind of probably won't show the whole thing, but it'll be close enough. No, it's just me. You can't see what I'm doing here. I'll have to fix that later. But I've got the pen tablet, which shows nothing, and I've got the computer screen above it, so I'm doing the whole drawing without looking at what I'm drawing and just watching the screen. For most people who have grown up doing that, that's probably a lot easier to do than for me, where I've actually gotten accustomed to looking at what I'm drawing and seeing what I'm doing. So there has been a learning curve for this. But my goal here with this channel is to use it to earn enough money to buy a pen display that I can then level up everything. And hopefully that'll increase both my productivity as well as my efficiency. Don't shoot. There we go. Alright, one more of these. Now the cool part about this being a television program of sorts is I've already pre-prepared the rest of this. You're just watching paint dry for this one process. All of these clips are already done. I really just wanted to make sure that I showed this process here because it's pretty key to what I'm trying to do, and it's also a pretty cool tool for anybody who wants to do one single drawing and then split it up into a couple of different frames. Make sure you get all these little guys covered because otherwise you're going to have spots all over it. Now, again, this is not the final animation. This is just the rough, so I'm not really putting a lot of effort into this. And this should be the last guy. When I'm done with this, I'll go in and rename the layers just so I don't lose track of them later in the mix, and then we'll get started doing the good stuff. One of the things I love about this pen is that it's selector and deselector at the same time. So I can get in there and fine-tune what it is that I'm taking out and making sure to leave as much of what I want in there as possible while taking out what I'm not wanting to keep. Real handy. All right, now this is going to be the slog, so bear with me here. Originally, I was going to animate every single one of these on one single frame, just overlap the whole thing, but it dawned on me that in doing so, I was messing up the backgrounds. I wasn't keeping them consistent, so this seemed like the easiest way to keep everything consistent. Just throw it on its own little layer, work that layer, and then move on to the next one. And one of the things you'll notice about the way that I've got my frames set up, I do a very simple layer setup when I'm doing each individual cell. I got the cell here, and then I've got the rough portion of it here. This is going to be the spot where everything gets inked. So once I've got these two guys locked in, that's where I put the ink down, and then the color. And the way that it lines up, it works out pretty well. I'll take you back to a frame just previous to all of this where I've got that in play here, and you'll see what I'm talking about. So here I've got the rough underneath, so you can see the rough outline, then throw in the ink, and then throw in the color. That way the whole entire cell is done exactly like a comic book page, so it's actually pretty simple to me. It's very intuitive. Now I know there's probably better ways of doing this, more professional ways of doing this, but I am neither better nor professional, so this is how you get it done in Roger world. There we go. All right, so now the first thing to do here is go in and darken all the wagon shots. I don't want them in here, so this is going to be just Dia shoving. I'll put the wagon in after, because the wagon's pretty easy to use. It's all cut and paste anyway. But the goal here is to work Dia first and get his animations locked in. I think he's the hardest one. And this is probably going to take the bulk of the day here. I've also got FX on this panel too, on this scene. I want to take those out too, because I've got a special treat in store for those. They start here. Wagon gone. Wagon gone. Wagon gone. There it is. FX. The wagon. The FX layer on here I'm going to do very simple. I'm just going to do a very light watercolor brush over where the smoke is, so that it's very, very subtle, very, very simple. And if it goes according to plan, it'll be the easiest part of this whole thing. But because I'm pretty sure everybody understands it, everyone's got a plan until they get hit in the mouth. I'm pretty sure I'll get hit in the mouth when it comes time to do that. Of note too, I'm also sitting right underneath my air conditioner. It's 106 outside right now, so if it gets a little bit loud, I apologize in advance, but I really don't. All right, here we go. So this is the rough on Dia. First thing I'm going to do is set up a second layer. Go in here and turn this down to about 30% so that it's a lot lighter. And then I'm just going to redraw the whole darn thing right on top. And I like doing these redraws in light blue so that I can differentiate between this and ink very easily. Plus, this turns a lot better to a lighter color than the blacks do. Those tend to get a little bit wonky when they get lightened up and go gray and sometimes get hard to see, but light blue, for some reason, stays clear on my screen and I can always see it. Now, because I'm not inking this, this is just a rough drawing. I don't have to be exactly perfect, but I want to make sure that I at least capture the subtle curves here so that I don't have to rethink those later. It's a lot easier to make the mistake here and fix it than it is to make it while you're inking and try and fix it in the finished process. I've seen other artists use the Tor box too, and if you don't know what that is, that's that little box device that sits on top of your desktop like a video game controller and lets you manipulate all of the screen turns that I'm having to go here and do manually. I want one of those. So that, in addition to the pen display, are the two things on my Christmas list. All right, that looks like a cowboy hat. Well, I don't like that. There we go. Now, while I'm in this stage here, I'm thinking about lighting, but I'm not perfecting it, so I just know that it's going to be rough right there. Shadow, light. I don't want that in there, but that's going to be the basic line that I'm using. This is just a rough. When I get into the actual shading portion of it, that's going to be a little easier to manipulate, but this is to give myself a rough idea of what it's going to look like. Sometimes it's good to step back because you see where you made your mistakes. And I just screwed that one up. If you need to know, well, you do because it's important. These three lines are very important. This line right here is the working area. That's where I try to keep everything that's important text-wise, character-wise, animation-wise. This buffer zone here is the edge of the screen. This line right here is the absolute border of the screen. This dark line here is a box that I've drawn around the whole entire thing so that none of the animations extend beyond that. This makes it easier when I go into coloring them because I've got a straight hard line here, so I can do these tangential lines that just kind of fall off, but that whole piece is just one area for me to color. It makes it a lot easier when I get into that stage doing it this way. So this area here from here in is the meat of the cartoon. This is my fungible zone where I can put not important things, but no text can go over here because I don't want the words to be here. I want everything that's going to be important to be within this zone. And that's what those are. I'll do a video later on down the line kind of showing how I get that set up, but because this is the first live video that I've ever done, and I don't even know if there's anybody watching at this point, I'm using it to kind of capture my workflow progress. Not so much the process. Not worried about getting the anatomy correct here, because when I get the wagon redrawn, I'll probably have to go back and redo all the placements here for the thumb. So this is just a placeholder. I've got 3 points of interest that are important on this particular scene. There's that hand, and that shoulder. I'm going to use this shoulder to show the overreach, the anticipation. He's going to use that to show how much effort he's putting into his shove here. But the rest of it is pretty much anywhere I want it to go. But that said, don't need to get terribly specific here because, again, when I get the wagon drawn in, I got to do the whole thing all over again. But I do like to incorporate as much of the final animation into this as I can. So like the folds, the shading, the intricate stuff like that, I want to throw in here at this stage so that I don't have to think about it when I'm getting into the finalization parts. Right, like so these little lines right here, those go in now. It's kind of like the spices, you get them added while the stew is cooking instead of afterwards so that they use the full flavor. And again, I want to apologize because I'm not watching the chat on here, so if you guys are throwing chats on there, I'm not looking at them at all. I'm watching just the animation software that I got going on in the background. Live streams, I'm looking at the chats right now in case you're wondering. I'm only going to do this one, but this one's going to last for a couple hours because I'm getting the whole thing done. Tip about my videos, multi-part, name them. Yeah, this isn't part one, part two, part three. This is just I screwed up the first two. And yes, you are listening to the voice of Roger. It's also the voice of the samurai, also the voice of Albert the Indian. The cowboy Dia is voiced by a friend of mine, Josh Rogers, and other people, other friends of mine who are willing to work for free are doing the voices of the other characters that you're going to be meeting here pretty soon. All right, now I'm turning the chat off. Back at work. And at this point, I like using the onion skin because this is the key to animating this smoothly. I make sure that I get all the action, all the lines following a certain line. I'm not drawing the line in here because that requires about 5 minutes more worth of work, and I don't want to do that today. That's a little too big of a hat for him. I'm going to get a little sketchy here because of this one right here, I didn't work out the animation as well as I could have or should have, so the anatomy is a little bit wonky. I'll just kind of put basic blocks in there, so I want to make sure I'm getting those out of the way. I promise, this part will clean up nicely. go back and forth on it, and you can see where it needs work. That's also the benefit of having the light box on, but with my sketchy stuff right here, that light box gets a little bit chaotic. There we go. That'll be the pig. Here's where that light box really shines, because it gets to line everything up in here. And keep it as consistent as possible while having to flip constantly from panel to panel. Elbow's moving because his whole entire body's shifting, so I can keep that. And you see the muscles here are tensing up on the forearm as he's getting more pressure into it, and the hand's actually shifted, so that works. I like it. Make sure the folds keep their same pattern, and you see the shoulder shifting slightly forward. That works. But I think I had it shifting forward a little bit more. No, that'll work. Doing a slight ease into this movement. I don't want the whole thing to go right out of the gate. This shoulder is going to stay pretty much where it is. It's going to move just a little bit as his whole body goes forward, but for the most part, it's going to stay right where it is, because this is the shoulder right here that's getting the work done. But I want to keep the hand in the same spot, more or less. It up a little bit because he's really gripping it hard. All right, here we go. Now let's get this guy done. I'm gonna work really, really fast here, and to do so, I gotta shut the hell up. So I hope you're not expecting Brent Musburger to come in and give the play-by-play here, because that's not happening. do that right in the microphone, guys. Sorry about that. But I got to see how this is playing. I'll give this just a second. I mean, Disney it ain't, but I'm kind of happy with it. Alright, so where were we? Here. This is also the time when I want solid, thin, straight lines, not this sketchy BS that I've got going on here right now. Mainly because I gotta filter through a lot of this nonsense, and solid lines are the easiest ones to see. Especially for subtle changes in movement. Not liking this yet, but it's still rough. Let's run it back. I think here it's going to be important to take this layer off too, so that I can kind of see where I've been and where I'm going. it's the motion I'm looking for. I just need to make it look good now. I can see right now that that arc is off, so I want to fix it in this rough stage where I'm at now. I want to make sure that all of those lines are following the same corner. Now, these are not going to stay, right? So they're going to be gone pretty quick, but that thumb can't get bigger as it slides away from you. This is the point where stuff begins to move pretty quick. Check that, because that is not what I'm looking for. I want movement, but this, because it's moving in space away from you and staying on the same plane, this little part right here doesn't move as fast. So get over here. There's something's going on here. I don't like it. All right, right there. There it is. You can't have body limbs changing spot like that. This dude's not plastic, man. This whole entire arm is pretty much staying in one spot this entire time at this angle. It doesn't really move. So while it is actually, in fact, sliding forward in space, it's moving away from you on a similar plane. So you can't really tell, or you shouldn't be able to at least. Oh, look at that. Look at that. Problem solved. I love it when a plan comes together, Hannibal. Okay, I want to keep that, but I want to move it a little bit. Now, these are just guidelines for the next frame, right? So when I get that next frame put in here, they change. I'll I'll get rid of them and add them to the second one. And here we are. That's the line that I'm keeping. Everything else is garbage. Alright, and you see that it just alters subtly. Shoot, I'm at the bottom of the tablet there, so it's falling off the damn page. Now, for those of you that know me, you're probably wondering why I haven't dropped an F-bomb up to this point. Don't worry. They're coming. Funny side story. I used to work for a local TV news station back in the youth. And I worked off camera, so I wasn't exactly one of the people that they trusted to be in front of the city of Dallas. But one day, Channel 8 in its infinite wisdom decided it would be a really, really good idea to put me on television at lunchtime. And yeah, I said the F word on live TV. But fortunately, I was so far off the camera that it didn't register. But in their infinite wisdom, the fine folks at Channel 8 never asked me to do that ever again. To be clear, I did warn them. And it was not intentional. Shit just happens that way. Alright, here's... I can see where I got the original animation messed up a little bit. Because you see how his hat gets bigger. The green line here is where I'd initially set it. The blue line here is the frame before. So he's getting bigger as he's dropping his head down. Can't have that happen. That ain't the way it's going to be. So let me get my arcs transferred. I want to do an arc on this too. It's going to be a little bit different. But it's going to be right along that same line. Because it is moving away, I gotta make it physically move. Now, those of you who have been following my animation journey know that I'm still relatively new at this. So I'm picking up tips, tricks, advice from every single resource that I could come across. And one of the sources that I came across specifically talking about what I'm doing here, which is making sure I'm animating something moving very subtly and very smoothly, told me to animate just outside the line to make it look like it's moving slowly. So that's what I'm kind of trying to do here. That's the line, and I'm just keeping it to the inside of it so that it's going to shift just a little bit that way, slowly over time. And get the shade line in there, because that's going to broaden out a little bit as that neck is getting exposed. And because he's reaching forward, the neck's moving forward just a little bit. Now his whole entire body is shifting too. He's going from an angle where this shoulder here is a lot closer to you, to one where they're getting spread out a little bit. No, my bad. It's going the opposite direction. Yeah, he's turning. That'll happen. Alright, so let's get my thumb put in. Because this is starting to move. Like on that. Oh yeah, that's it. Now see how weird the thumb getting bigger looks? It's not following the path that I want that to follow at all. Just on the outside edge, and then we've got subtle movement. drawbacks to not having a mirror. I can't look at what my hair looks like as it's traveling in space from the back of my head. Back to what I was saying about rough lines, they don't do you good at this stage. You want to clean it up as much as possible so that when you get to the inking, there is no question. One thing I've noticed about doing animation, it's a lot like what I'd imagine making a symphony is like, because I got to pay attention to so many individual little bitty moving parts, like the subtle wiggle going on right there on that neck. If you're just blasting through this, you're not going to pay attention to that. And there it is, right there. You got to really focus and concentrate on what these 3D objects look like moving through space. That's why this onion skin is invaluable. You can see the subtle variation that you're putting in there. And if it works, you're doing good. If it doesn't work, you're doing bad. It's pretty simple. Trust it. And wisely so. I got the whole shoulder moving, but I've got that staying perfectly still. It needs to move right there. Get the bulk in there. Now, as far as stuff I've got upcoming, this will be the part where I can kind of talk about that, because I got time to kill here. The first Saturday of the month of October, which is now roughly 2 months away, there's the 24-hour comic book day. And for those of you that don't know, that is comic book creators, of which I am one. That's our Boston Marathon, so that's where we get out and see if we've got what it takes to write and draw a full 24-hour comic in, I'm sorry, full 24-page comic in 24 hours. It is not easy, and I've done one for the last dozen years. This story, in fact, right here, comes from one of those. For those of you who've watched Big Iron and have come to this channel via that, that story itself was born from a 24-hour comic where I wanted to tell the story from Texas Red's point of view, and that just kind of blossomed into an actual cartoon. Wait, hold on. Gotta get the hand right first. So that is what I've got going on. I'm gonna do a live stream for it all day, starting at... Wait, hold on. I gotta do the arm on this one. I knew I was forgetting something. So it'll start at 12 noon on whatever that Saturday is, and it'll run through whatever time I get finished. Usually get these things done pretty quick, so I figure start at noon, be done by 10 a.m., maybe 9. All right, I can see a problem here. That's what happens when I get distracted. Yep, there it is. I screwed this one up. I didn't draw the arm in between the in-between. So, let's turn that onion skin on, and I've got 0.1 and 0.2, 0.1 and 0.2. So, this guy should be right there, because I'm going for full fluid motion. Turn that guy off. Ha, Clip Studio, you love to save and recover my information. I appreciate that. For those of you that don't use this software, this is the biggest pet peeve I've got with it right here, is it freezing up on me in mid-flow and saving to recover. There's a 50-50 chance that it doesn't come back from this. May the odds ever be in your favor. All right, so... I want the hand here. That's the line for it, and here's where I'm at now, so... That's the line, and here's where I'm at, so... Now I want to see this in action before I do anything further on this page. So glad I caught that, because it threw everything off. I'm not sold on this, so so that's going to change later, but I want to keep it in there now because it's a basic target line for those folds. They will modify through time. I'm just not to the point where I want to do it yet. All right, so where's my hand? Here it goes. Now the arc on here, it's pretty simple. And I can change this later down the line as I get into the point where I'm doing the wagon, which will be right after this. Now this is the outside line, so I'm going to have to put knuckles in here at some point. I just want to put that in there to remind myself that I got to do knuckles. Important to keep the clothing aspect accurate. He's got a vest on and it doesn't just stop right at the shoulder. It kind of comes in a little bit. And sometimes I forget that and end up suffering for it because I do something I don't like that I see later and it makes me cringe. See, that looks like he's wearing a vest. I see a little goofy jump right here. That's that thumb getting bigger. I don't like that thumb getting bigger. He's got to follow an arc on there. Bad animator. whole entire process all over again. Oh, lovely. I know I was missing the setup on this. Now you'll notice if you look to the bottom right, I'm not on the right frame. That's okay, because I can change that once I get the selection done. That's one of the cool things about Clip, is it works really closely like Photoshop, and you can do one thing in one frame and translate it to another pretty easily. And if you get the basic version of this, you can do like a 3-second play around animation. That's how I started. I got that and played around with it. Figured out that I had something of an inclination towards this, and bought the rest. So let's cut that, deselect, paste that, and then throw a new frame in there, bang, put my onion skin on, and let's get this guy drawn. Wait, turn down the opacity to 30. I think I can get away with turning off that. Get that pencil back. I knew it, on the wrong one. Lovely. One thing I can say, before I started doing this cartoon, the High Swallow specifically, I was garbage at drawing cowboy hats in 3D. Couldn't do it. It was impossible. It eluded me. But because I have had to draw so damn many cowboy hats over the course of the last 6 months, I've gotten pretty talented. Well, not talented is a stupid word. I've gotten pretty good at it. That whole thing about with practice comes skill. Well, hopefully I'm getting to that point, but Lord knows I put some practice into drawing stupid cowboy hats. And here's the fun part, because that stays right where it is. Now this one, I'm not real concerned about getting the lines right, because again, I just screwed them up. But in the inking process, it's going to come a lot easier. And at this point, I just want to make sure that the armature lines up properly and the proportions aren't skewed. So here, elbow crease, forearm. There we go. And get that erased. If anyone has any questions about what it is that I just did, I can do an anatomy drawing tutorial later down the line. I'm going to do a couple for some techniques that I have developed. And I say that word loosely, because I'm pretty sure that there are better ways of doing it. But if I came up with something through this software that I think is going to be useful that wasn't available in the software, I want to do a little bit of a tutorial to kind of share that. So I've got three of those coming. All based off of specific little things that I did to get a cinematic effect out of the software that was not included in the original version of the software, so I basically made it up from scratch. And then this would explain why it didn't look right. manage to do that. Oh well. We'll rename that Dia, and then we'll just flush this old guy. There we go. So turned off, turned on now. Let's see if we got our motion in there. Exactly on board with that hand movement. But when I get the wagon put in there, I think, if I remember properly, it's going to line up. Alright, cool. Where were we? I think I see a problem here that I can fix right now. Yep, this has got to go. Now, this is a cool trick too with the selection pin. If you got something in there that's at an angle that you just need to change, you get that selection pin in there. And let's go full screen on this so that I can get the whole thing in there. And you get the whole thing selected, you make sure that the outside lines aren't going to be affected, so I don't want any of those to be knocked out. And then you go to this little scale rotate guy, drag your cross to the elbow. Wait, hold on, I did it out of shape here, out of order. Alright, get the onion skin on there, that way you can see the motion. Now I want to scale rotate this guy a little bit more, keeping in frame with that movement. I want to get that movement to the same degree. Alright, now dump that, go to the next one, because this one's jacked up too, but it's not jacked up as bad. Again, you get the selection tool, get the whole thing in there, drag the cross down to the elbow. You can go off box, you don't have to stay in the same box, and then go out there, because I'm going from here to here, so it's a big push, right? So he's getting some motion on this thing. It'll be right there. Now, the cool part is, if I screw this up and I get the wagon back in there and it doesn't fit, I can do the exact same thing to move it back. Get my pencil selected again. Get my hands. That elbow's got some action in it, so it's here now. So one thing about this elbow setup right here, shoulder elbow being on that same plane, is almost identical to this one. They're following the same thing. What happens here is he's coming in, he's leaning in, and that elbow is playing catch up. So I may need to revisit that arc, because I'm not exactly satisfied with it. It looks like it's jumping a little. The proportions are okay, but the corner, that's the thing where you see there's motion in there. And look at those hands. Look at those hands. Yep, that was it. That fixed it. gasket off. I left the arm out. Now, periodically, one of the things that I do while I'm doing these animations is I will set up a layer in the reference folder right here, and I'll put a cell in there to do my arc on. So I gotta turn it live. I'll turn that off. So here, I'll do all my points. Let me get that circle turned off so it's not as goofy. Alright, and it gets a little tricky here because I've got to jump forward in the timeline, but on the same, on a different level. I got to keep it here. Okay, so here. Now I got shoulder here, elbow here, hand here. Hand here, elbow here, shoulder here. So, now I want to go back in time here to the next panel. Alright, at this stage, I change the color because I want to keep the second movement different. If it's different. And then so on. Kind of tricky with the colors, but it really does keep it scalable because then you can really see where you're screwing up on the next panel. Right there. And here, here, here. See, there, you see the arc changing right there, right? That's what I'm talking about. He's up here, while he's here, and he's still here. He is here, so that arc is going down this way. This arc needs to be going forward, and this arc needs to be moving forward this way. So I want him going in a nice circle. I want him going in a nice circle. I want him going in a nice circle. Him going in a nice circle. Him barely moving at all. But I got to get from that to that, and from that to that. Now, ideally, that line goes like this. Wait, hold on. I want to go baby green on that. So I want that arc to go here, that arc to go here, that arc to go here, 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 and here. Let's go to the next one, see where I'm at. There we go. Now, watch, and you'll see the problem happen right there. Okay, here's why it's not that bad. Because at this point, right here, he's extending. So all I gotta do is get everything on that line right there. Keep that stuff on that line and keep him there. I'm pretty good on this. I mean, I need that dip right there, I'm not happy with. Which one is that? That one. But it doesn't look bad. It flows pretty good. That's really just transcription error for me drawing the X in the wrong spot. But that, gotta fix that. Let me give you a brief primer on my hierarchy here. The title box is where I keep all of the sound effects, the dialogue, the theme song, the title, the logo, all that good stuff. I keep that in here and I keep it close so that I don't mess with it, don't jack with it, don't even have to see it. And I usually keep it turned off so that I don't even have it popping up in the display. I have a reference folder too where I'll put this little guy right here, which is my color chart for all the different characters. I do one of these for every single character so that I keep the color consistent across the entire platform. That's really handy. Cool part that I'm going to go into much later is right below that, I got the mouths folder. Now here is where I do all of the animation for all the different mouths and then go into the scene for the individual portion of it. Because I got it turned off, you can't see it, but I will animate the mouths in this space right here. But I'll do that on these cells so that I can then just put mouth shape 1, mouth shape 2, mouth shape 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 all the way through and then just intersperse through those. It's a very quick and very efficient way of doing the talking without having to go and do it on every single panel. And I'll do those on ones. Well, technically I'm only working off a 12 frame per second sheet, so ones for me is basically twos for anybody else. But it makes it very easy to do the lettering, to do the mouth shapes for the talking. I'm going to do a tutorial on that to kind of walk anybody that wants to learn more about that through the process so they can see what I do if they're interested. But for right now, I just want to get this bad boy done. Let's drag that back out. Alright. So where was I? I got a frame in here that doesn't look right. And there it is. And you see, it just looks weird. Right? It's not following that same arc, but he's pushing. So it doesn't have to be that bad of a fix. I can probably get in here. Wait, I don't want to do that. Deselect. Come in here. Right? Alright, so all I gotta do is really just move that portion down. So I'm gonna select it. I'm gonna do control arrow so that it grabs it and just drags it down and moves it. And get it a little bit closer to where it needs to be. Boom, I think that's it. Now, it's a matter of lining this guy back up again. And that's what good old onion skin's for. Get my pencil back. Oh, there we go. I got the wrong dang color. You guys almost heard your first F-bomb. Get out of there. So I gotta go from here. Bingo. that worked. First thing I want to do is turn off the reference layer, so get rid of that. Turn onion skin off, and then let's just roll it. Oh, yep. You guys are wondering, or at least I am, probably thinking you are too, why the hell I am putting so much effort into just over 1 second worth of animation. I really want this stuff to be good. I want to make it a lot better than what I've been putting out. And this is part of that process. The whole goal with this, when I started it, was to put as much content out as quickly as possible so that I was throwing out 30 seconds to a minute of content every single week. Can't keep that. That's not a good schedule because the animation was getting bad. This episode, I'm taking a little bit more time. He says after taking 2 months to get it done right. Okay, I think we're good. Now, let's go back in here and start with the wagon. And get that little wagon turned back on. See if it still works. The wagon's pretty simple. That's just straight up lines. I'm not going to get too terribly detailed in there because that's just a minute. I'm sorry, not a minute. That's just a second of animation, and it's not important. Ooh, I got a tingle. Everything stayed where it was supposed to be, more or less. I got to move that over just a little, but that stayed right where it needs to be. The lean in's there, the push away. Oh, yeah, that worked. Okay, good deal. Now, with this, I'm going to rename this layer Dia, and I am going to dump these. Let's see how that looks before I go into the wagon. Yeah. Alright, I like it. So let's go ahead and turn the cowboy off. Now there's going to be overlap on this. I'm cool with that. I am absolutely okay with that. I'm not going to be terribly bent out of shape. What happened here? Alright, some of my sequencing got thrown off. I'll have to fix that when I get to it. Basically, what you've all just seen is me set myself up with a time bomb. Fun. Alright, same process. I'm going to do 30% on all these. That one's already set. This one is not. overlay onto those, or I draw the actual final version. But because this is just lines, it's going to be a lot quicker. Okay, now the biggest obstacle on this, or the trick spot, if you will, is this big giant wagon wheel. The wagon itself, I can draw once, and forget, because I'm going to do that same object move button with it that I did with the hand. Really, really effective tool to do that that kind of manipulation. And when you get into animating a figure, if you feel like you want to put a rig together and do something like that, yeah, that's how you do it. You do that object manipulation. It gets into keyframes and crap like that, but that's the trick. You can do that in Clip. It's not suited for it, but it is possible. I did that in one of the scenes from Big Iron. I wasn't happy with how it turned out, but it did what I wanted it to do, so I didn't complain. Alright, now, this is a broken spoke. Did a lot of research into busted up wagons on the prairie. One of the biggest problems that would break these wagons is the wagon wheels popping off. The steerage component was the one that they broke the most, and right here at this frame, this little box is connected on a spiral to the center of the wagon, and then these wheels turn off of that pivot right here at the middle, but they're held on the place with a little plate that comes off of here, and that little guy right there, if they went up and down too far, this could snap completely clean of there, and you just lost yourself a wagon wheel. Alright, so I'm going to turn this guy off, and I'm going to do something stupid here and pin that, because I don't want there to be difference between this. I want to be able to spot right away that that's a different layer. I don't want to make any kind of confusion as I get closer. Now, because this is a big deal, a big box, right? I don't want to do the pen thing. I just want to cover the whole area. And here's where we get into the spot, the mix up, because shoot. Z. V. Alright. So we'll go in here to this one. And we'll just match it. And then because it's a simple image, paste it down, we do the spin, we do the alignment, we get it squared away. It's got a good flow. All right, I like it. Now, I got multiple layers in here, right? And I want to keep them all the same. So I'm going to do some merge layer stuff going on here. This is basic bookkeeping, because I don't like having all these unnamed layers floating. And it gets real tricky if you make a new layer and you've got a bunch of layers in there. Make a new cell, you've got multiple layers in there, they're gonna... Wait, hold on. Something happened here. Alright, I got another. I don't need that. There we go. And we're going backwards. Alright, let's flow through here, make sure everything's good. Alright. Got that part done. Now to get the wagon wheel in, and that is gonna be the same thing. We're gonna do curve lines in here. I keep all of this stuff set up in my quick access so that I do not have to keep jacking around with that. I can go into here and I can have curve line, straight line, polyline, continuous curve, spline, Bezier, all this good stuff in here. But because I'm doing the wagon wheel, I want that curve line. Now I'm going to do this on one and translate it to all of the others just like I did that first one. But when you're doing curves, you got to do a little bit of homework. This is where it gets tricky. So bear with me. This is going to take just a minute. You've got to draw a box. And you've got to draw it in perspective. Right. Then you do this little trick right here, which is corner to corner, so you get your center line. You do this little guy right here so that you know what your middles are. Did I just do that on the wrong level? Yeah, I did. Ah, dang it. Alright, good. Okay, I don't need that. I got... Well, shoot, I'm going to have to do this all over again. Alright, so bear with me. I screwed up. Let's do this again. Run this back. So that is the wheel. That is the corner, or the X rather. Now that is the middle. That is the corner. Here's why this is important. Cut that off, and what do we have? We have a wagon wheel in space. It's not showing up right. Let me get this. That might be a little easier to manipulate. All right, good. So, do that. And then I want that wagon wheel to come down a little bit. So we'll do that. Just continue that line up, continue that line up, and there we go. Alright, so now let's do this for the depth of the wheel. Now if you've ever wanted to know how to draw a wagon wheel in perspective in space using 3D, this is the trick. Alright, let's get my curved line back. Now, you go from here to here and drag it to that corner. here to here, drag it to that corner. Here to here, technically it's up a little bit. Keep these lines straight, drag it to that corner. Here to here, drag it to that corner, right? It is such a stupid easy process to draw a perfect circle in perspective using the software that you have. Again, it doesn't even have to be perfect because you're using it as a framework. Back to this little guy. Now, it's not big enough, so that's cool. Alright, I'm going to do this. I'm not liking that. See, that's a lot of work just to fill these little spaces. And I wanted it. Shit. Okay, that didn't work. Well, cool part about that is you can start it all over again. Okay, so here. Get the straight lines. You don't want the curved ones here. Here. This way I don't have to mess with it. Same process though. Get that wagon out of there, and then I got just the 3D in space. And you know what? Let's go ahead and make it even easier. Let's get it front and center. This works for any curve that you've got going on in space. And my art teacher in college taught me this. Now here you really do need to establish your vanishing point, especially if you're going into perspective, so let's just go ahead and drag that out. And because we're going to that, that's it. We're not really set on a vanishing point here, so I'm just going to go corner to corner. And then go up into there. Alright. Get rid of any extraneous lines. This is a frame into another layer, so forgive me for breaking my original rule, but here we go. Again, corner to corner. Gotta get all of it in view, otherwise it won't work. And then just to the parallel line. See how quickly it lines up. Even in perspective. And you have yourself a perfect circle in space. I do. Right there. Here to here. Boom. Here to here. Boom. Now you may have to clean up the joints, but this is pretty basic. Okay, now I don't need this, and I don't need this. Well, yeah, I do. I need that for a minute. Let's get these guys back in the party. Okay, that center line's important because that's got to line up with this axle. But the wheel angle needs to be skewed. Alright, now we're good. Because I got to do the exact same thing here. Get rid of my guidelines. These aren't really very important because they're background, tertiary stuff. Okay, now I need spokes in this guy, even though I'm not drawing every single one of them. I kind of need to know where they are. Got a center point right there. So we'll do that. We'll do that. And it's probably going to work better if I use a line tool just to make it straight. There. There. And I'm getting into a range where it's not even going to be on camera, but I want to make sure that it at least lines up if I decide to take it out. That. Get rid of that. Get rid of that. Back pencil. Spoke. None of this is going to be seen. So none of this is necessary. Alright. Go back to the lair where I got this. No, it's not necessary. Make sure I turn 100 and turn that back off again. I don't need it. long as they extend outside, I'm good. Okay. Who here sees what I've just done wrong? Again, the spokes on this wheel are important. Because they meet at a central point, and there's not a lot of space in between them, so this guy is going to be right on that one. Very limited space. That party is very, very crowded. At the edge of that drawing, I can get a little bit more curve in there. I don't have to worry about losing it because all of this stuff is off camera. You're never going to see it. Now, the cool part is shading this little guy because the sun is right up on this. This guy's going to be black. This guy's going to be black. And the shade comes right up into there. Back and how does it look? Alright, I like it. Now the cool part. I can get rid of him. I copy that. Go back one. Paste. Oop. I didn't see that one coming. Alright. So now, copy, paste, 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 paste. And go back in here because I've already got the movement packaged. When I start the movement, all right, there. Okay, I got something in the frame. When you do this and it shows additional stuff down in here, that means that you have got stuff in here somewhere. No, do not apply transformation. Turn that off. Turn a wagon off. Turn layer 19. Turn that off. There's a quick and dirty way to do this. I want to select all of this area. I want to invert it. I want to delete. And then turn all this junk back on, and then my wagon turns back into a wagon wheel. soon as I get this scene done, I'm going to wrap it up. I'm not going to jump into the big scene with Dia because it's becoming a little bit distracting to focus on this instead of just focusing on the art. So when I got these three panels knocked out, make sure that I'm not screwing myself up later. Select invert, delete. Turn that onion skin off and go one at a time. All right, here we go. Messed up there. Bingo. And there. And there. Ooh, that's bad. Setting this corner, and this corner is waypoints, and you can see that also dictates where the line needs to be because it didn't line up there either. All right, roll it. Good, let's turn that wagon off on all of them and make sure that it lines up. Not smooth as I'd like it to be, but it will work. All right, let's couple it with our little cowboy. But before we do that, housekeeping. Here's where it gets a little bit tricky because I've got the wagon layer transparent turned off. But when you do the merge layer thing, the layer that you've got selected, that naming convention takes place and precedent over these two. So when I merge this, all of it turns into the wagon layer. So if I keep that turned off, I don't have to do as much work renaming the stuff, which is why I wasn't terribly worried about getting the naming conventions thrown off earlier. And it's active. So let's get the cowboy popped in there now. Okay, moment of truth. Does it play? I want pressure there, got it. I want pressure here. So I gotta move that hand a little bit forward, and then we're done. All right, that worked. Okay guys, I'm going to go ahead and end the stream now, and this is going to be it for the rest of the day, but this episode that we're looking at here, I'm almost finished with. I saved this scene for the last because I knew it was going to be the toughest one to get, and I kind of wanted to do a little bit of a process video to show how it was knocked out. So that's done. That's live. I'm not going to do any of the rest of this stuff because I've got plans for that coming up later down the line. What I want to do eventually is I want to put together a kind of a series of how I do this stuff videos. I'm going to do process videos starting with the template, doing the initial storyboarding, how I get the animations popped in, and then another full depth version of this. And I'm going to do just a basic scene where I go from the beginning to the end in like a 3 or 4 part series. In addition to that, I'm going to throw together a couple of the process videos on how I do specific things, like how I do the focal shift that I used on the street scene in a couple of episodes back, how I do the talking, the lip sync videos, how I do that. There's a couple of other little tricks and tips that I've popped in, like moving backgrounds and how to keep everything locked in when I'm doing those, and keeping the animation tight in. I've got a couple of those process videos lined up for the future. This was really me testing the process and seeing if this whole entire streaming thing and live video works. So when I get this knocked out, I'll start popping some videos on here so you guys can get some behind-the-scenes content. Also of note, I've got 2 other projects that I'm working on simultaneously, which is another reason this is taking so darn long to get finished. Those projects, I don't want to talk about until they're done, but if you liked Big Iron, you're going to like these. And I'm not talking about Westerns. I'm talking about the music video portion of what I'm doing here. So I've got my content here, which is the High Swallow. And then I've got that, which is going to be pretty cool too. So keep yourself tuned to here if you want to see all that cool stuff. And while I'm not taking any requests to do other music videos, number one reason for that being I don't own the rights to that. So yeah, I got a 1.5 million view video in Big Iron, but I haven't made a cent off of that. I don't make anything off of stuff that I don't own. The High Swallow, on the other hand, the Portland Express, on the other hand, the other stuff that I've got on here that I do own, that's what I do, that's what I make money off of, and that's what I want to focus on moving forward. But that said, I'm still going to do a few of the cool things too. So keep your eyes peeled, basically, because I got more stuff coming. Thanks.